Evening. Welcome to the Wesak webinar of the 2025 initiative. Let's have an alignment together. Align within your vehicles, your physical, etheric, emotional, mental, finding the position of stillness and silence. Tune in with own soul. Visualize the circle of people gathered today for this webinar. Joining from all over around the world. See the lights connecting, the lights of this, our individual souls connecting into the ring of glowing light. Standing together in intention to serve humanity through our meditation. We extend our alignment to the new group of world servers. Who work everywhere in the world, actively and behind the scenes, preparing the way for the externalization of the hierarchy and the reappearance of the Christ. We connect with all people of goodwill around the world through the radiance of our hearts and the radiance of the heart center of the new group of world servers. Through our collective heart center, we align with the heart center of the spiritual hierarchy of the planet, the Christ. together, we sound the mantra of unification. The sons of men are one, and I am one with them. I seek to love, not hate. I seek to serve and not exact due service. I seek to heal, not hurt. Let pain bring due reward of light and love. Let the soul control the outer form and life and all events, and bring to light the love which underlies the happenings of the time. Let vision come and insight. Let the future stand revealed. Let inner union demonstrate and outer cleavages begun. Let love prevail. Let all men love. Thank you. Welcome again to our Wesak Festival webinar. My name is Alexander and I am greeting you on behalf of the coordination group of the 2025 initiative. Today we enter in the 7 days period of the Wesak Festival. Wesak is the highest point of the spiritual year. It's the highest point of spiritual contact between all the kingdoms on the planet. And in this time of this festival, humanity has a special opportunity to raise own spiritual vibrations, attuning with the higher realms, to contact the spiritual hierarchy of the planet, which in its turn align connecting with Shambhala, receiving the blessings of Buddha, who transmits at this time once a year the blessings to the entire planet. So this is our opportunity for our service to aligning together to bring the higher light for humanity through our collective meditation. As many usual period for the full moon alignment is 5 days. However, Joel Kuhl mentioned that Wesak can be considered as a 7 days festival, and so therefore today we enter the first day, while the actual full moon of Taurus or full moon Wesak will be on April 22nd at 5:25 in the morning GMT time. So with this webinar on the first day of Wesak, we strive to create a global alignment between members of the new group of world servers. Definitely it's, in a way, it's a symbolic alignment, but through establishing this channel today, we will keep our intention that during this festival of the Wesak 2016, as many as possible people of goodwill all around the world will align with the spiritual realms and with dedication to serve humanity in this time of extreme need. The topic of our today's webinar is recognizing emerging light, which is also the topic of the 2025 initiative this year. Bringing this topic as a theme for our work this year, we recognize the importance of the emerging light, light that emerges within each of us as the light of own soul. And as we know the light of own soul, we can recognize the same light in others, connecting with them and building bridges of understanding. Same way we, through recognition of own light, we connect with the essence of other traditions, of other cultures, of other concepts, thus building bridges and contributing to strengthening of the network of light on the planet. And through the same process of recognition of light, we can relate to the spiritual hierarchy, the fifth kingdom on the planet, through recognition and resonance. We can cooperate with hierarchy, and especially in this time of Vesak, of global planetary alignment, when, according to the legend, Buddha approaches the planet and the Christ receives the blessings from Shambhala and holds this blessing for the entire month till the next full moon in Gemini, and when he distributes through the spiritual hierarchy to the planet, to people all over the world. So today we are working together, bringing in symbolic alignment five continents through people on those continents who will share with us the note of their continent and their impressions from meditation on the theme recognizing emerging light. And so let's begin. So we inwardly bring our eyes to the continent of Africa.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes. And hello, Klisha. Klisha van Zyl is from South Africa, and the floor is yours, Klisha. Please.
Hi, good evening. My name is Klisha van Zyl. I'm from South Africa, and it's my pleasure to be here tonight. I would like to lead you in a short alignment. I would like the group to focus their consciousness on the beacon of knowledge of Africa, the ancient school of Horus, as well as the school of Master Moira, the pyramids of Giza in Egypt. Then I would like the group to bring their consciousness together and link it to the southern point of Africa, South Africa, and link the group consciousness to the Angel of Table Mountain in Cape Town. And finally, link both inclusively in our consciousness to the underlying soul, the heart of Africa. And sound the note of Africa. The golden eye of Taurus, quoting from Astrolic Astrology, points the way to those who likewise see that which is gold will someday too respond, passing from east to west in that dire time when urge to gather gold shall rule the lower half, the personality aspect of men and nations. The search for gold, the search for golden light divine, directs the bull of life, the bull of form. These two must meet, and meeting, clash. Thus vanishes the gold. Africa, to my mind, is closely related to Taurus. Being an earth sign, it also relates to the mineral kingdom, holding vast riches within itself. This is the story of Africa. With the movement from west to east, we saw the spread of selfish domination by the west. The west saw the resources of this vast continent and started to plunder the riches, the minerals such as gold and diamonds, under the flag of colonization. For the last 100 years, Africans have struggled to liberate themselves from this colonization. And while standing under flags of freedom, the liberators are just continuing where the colonists ended, selling the minerals and other mining opportunities to the highest bidder, mainly to afford weapons to stay in power. Chris Hani, a South African ANC activist and liberator, was immersed in this struggle for freedom and paid with his life for the freedom of his people. He realized the problems that Africa will be dealing with before his death. And I quote, "What I fear is that the liberators emerge as elitists who drive around in Mercedes Benzes and use the resources of the countries to live in places and gather riches." I quote again from Esoteric Astrology. "That which impelled the process of involution and evolution, the desire to incarnate, takes form at the second initiation, the will to liberation in Taurus, and finds itself released through the will to serve, universally in Aquarius." The will to liberate lies within Taurus. And the struggle is only in its infancy. The desire for freedom was so great in Africa that the people led into a severe ongoing conflict within Africa. The majority of countries in Africa have been liberated from the colonial oppressors, and they still find themselves in the position of being dominated by their own leaders. The current African leaders are in a difficult situation. How do you implement power rightfully if your country is still dependent on the income of the former oppressors, and the lure of materialism is so strong that it is easy to succumb and sell out the people to stay in power. This leaves the people in Africa in fear as well as a state of pity. Some also turn to the lure of materialism as a means to escape, or grasp at the gospel message of Jesus saves that is spreading through Africa. Some customary leaders see it as a curse of Africa that brings diseases like Ebola, TB, HIV, and malaria. Master Dwell Carl says that the keynotes of this sign are, as usual, clear in the implications. One state, the note of the form aspect, let the struggle be undismayed. The word of form is to take, grasp, and go courageously after that which is desired. The word of soul is, I see, and when the eye is opened, all is light. Africa needs to bring the emerging light into the heart of Africans to clear the way for goodwill. When Africans look through the lens of goodwill, the light will show that they are ethical and accountable leaders that carry the will of the people in their hearts and work selflessly towards the benefit of African people and Africa. Africa will stand in world service. Thank you, Alexander. That is the note of Africa.
Thank you very much, Klisha. And now we move in to the continent of America. So let's bring our focus to the joint continent of South and North America.
Hello everyone.
Veronica. Veronica Pelikarik from Canada and Argentina, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, and good afternoon, everyone. I would like to start the alignment by reciting the great invocation in Spanish. La gran invocación. Desde el punto de luz en la mente de Dios, que afluya luz a la mente de los hombres, que la luz descienda a la tierra. Desde el punto de amor en el corazón de Dios, que afluya amor a los corazones de los hombres, que Cristo retorne a la tierra. Desde el centro donde la voluntad de Dios es conocida, que el propósito guíe a las pequeñas voluntades de los hombres, el propósito que los maestros conocen y sirven. Desde el centro que llamamos la raza de los hombres, que se realice el plan de amor y de luz, y selle la puerta donde se halla el mal. Que la luz, el amor y el poder restablezcan el plan en la tierra. So I would like to present myself a little bit. I grew up in Argentina, and what we are seeing now is the beautiful Quebrada de Humahuaca in the north of Argentina, in the province of Jujuy. It is patrimony of humanity, and it is very beautiful, and it's full of mystery. And so after spending the first 40 years of my life roaming around a little bit, I finally came to North America and then to Canada. And now for 17 years, I work for Pache Bene Nonviolent Service. And we are an organization that educates, promotes, and serves the cause of nonviolence. I would like now to read two quotes, one from Gandhi and one from Martin Luther King, which I think are very appropriate to our theme of recognizing the emerging light. Nonviolence is the greatest and most active force in the world. One person who can express nonviolence in life exercises a force superior to all the forces of brutality. My optimism rests on my belief in the infinite possibilities of the individual to develop nonviolence. The more you develop it in your own being, the more infectious it becomes, till it overwhelms your surroundings and by might oversweep the world. That is Mohandas K. Gandhi. And now from Martin Luther King Jr. An individual has not started living until he or she can rise above the narrow confines of his or her individualistic concerns to the broader concerns of all humanity. So what I have been seeing from working a lot in the United States and in South America is that 10 years ago, nonviolence was considered an utopic, a wonderful thing, but fundamentally utopic. And, you know, we could admit conflict resolution, mediation, but nonviolence, it was something we didn't want to get too close to. However, in the past 10 years, nonviolence has become more and more like mainstream, like something that we recognize as a great and possible way of living and creating possibilities and change in the world in all the different domains, like, you know, making war obsolete, our interest in climate issues, environmental issues, the Pope writing an encyclical on the environment, the growth in principles of nonviolence is establishing itself in terms of awareness in the schools, and children are beginning to really become very active participants in this movement because it is becoming more and more a movement, and that is really a great factor in my understanding of an emerging light. Last year, Pache Bene, the organization that I work for, we organized 350 actions. These are the photos that you're seeing throughout the United States, involving every single state in the United States. People proclaiming through different issues, immigration laws, etc., the need for a change in paradigm, a nonviolent change in paradigm, and it is incredible to see to what an extent people get enthusiastic when we talk about this. So this is a sign for me, I think, that things are really changing. And also, insofar as our need to accept differences and bring down the barriers of the us versus them idea, which is obviously completely illusory and created by our belief systems and our conditioning. So I want to share with you this good news. Nonviolence principles and strategies too are beginning to become recognized There is a woman in Rhode Island who has established a nonviolence program in schools. And it's so successful that more and more schools want to be taught by her to see how they can establish it in their own places of in their own educational system. So this is what I wanted to share fundamentally as a sign of recognizing emerging light, is that we are becoming much more sensitive to the need for a change in paradigm, for a change in the way we view each other. And that's good news in the midst of enormous chaos, in the midst of the refugee crises, in the midst of the bombings. And there is that other consciousness that is awakening and beginning to make its mark in us. I would like to go back a little bit to some of the pictures here that you're seeing. You know, there is the young people, the adolescents, in some ways we always think that how do we make a connection to them, you know, because nonviolence activists seem to be all kind of in the kind of later echelons of life, you know, like 50 upwards. But that is not so. As you can see, there's lots of young people here demonstrating and participating. And this is the wonderful thing, really, about nonviolence, that it is not only liberating, it is democratic because everybody can participate. It's liberating, it's democratic, it includes everybody. Look at all these children. Isn't that hopeful? Isn't that wonderful? And all these different races that you see in these photos, right? So basically that's what I want to share today. And I spent the Canadian winter this time in Argentina and Brazil, and I see the same phenomenon happening there in different characteristics, because every country has their own way of expressing. But for example, in Argentina, which I'm sure this is going to surprise everybody, but insofar as gender violence, it ranks second as the most violent country in South America for gender violence, the first one being Honduras. And there was a demonstration where millions of people went to the streets and proclaimed the slogan, "Ni una más," not one more, meaning not one more woman who is going to suffer gender violence, but millions and millions, they went into the street. So these are signs of the times too, like we are changing, we are wanting change, and we're looking forward to it. So thank you so much for listening, and thank you so much for inviting me to this panel. It's been an honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Veronica. Thank you very much for your sharing. And now we move in our inner eyes to the continent of Asia. And I want to invite Starling Hunter, who lives in Qatar and works in Qatar and in Sweden. So Starling, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Will I be able to share my screen?
Yes, just a second.
Okay. All right, thank you. This presentation will cover a few of the many sacred sites of Asia, and I'll have a little commentary for you on those. So just a little bit of background about me before our brief alignment. I live in Stockholm, Sweden, and work as a professor of business administration for an American university with a campus in Doha, Qatar, which borders Saudi Arabia. And so my name may be familiar to a few of you, possibly because of work related to the Great Invocation. There's the 7-volume series on the Great Invocation entitled The Compass of Life, which some of you might be familiar with. And there's also a few people who are here on the list and participating this evening are helping me with the mass distribution of the Great Invocation to the global English-speaking Christian community via Twitter. And you can see the handle there. And if you want to know more about either of these projects, contact information is there. You can send an email at any point. Just a very brief alignment, which you can do yourself. It'll take about 30 seconds to do it, but you'll notice there's an image here of places of peace and power in the continent of Asia. And although the graph here, the map is a little bit limited in terms of what it considers Asia, you can see the spread of those are around a good part of Asia. So I'll let you consider those for a few moments, and then we'll talk about some of them specifically, including some that are actually in what's often referred to as the Middle East, which is the southwest corner of Asia. Okay. So we'll move forward and consider some of these places. The first is one which I have not visited, but because of the work that I do where I do it, I know many people who go every year. And it is the Great Mosque, the Masjid al-Haram, which is in Mecca in Saudi Arabia. And the Great Mosque is the largest mosque in the world. And it surrounds Islam's holiest place, the Kaaba, which you can see as a square up toward the center and upper half of the image. And Muslims face in the direction of the Kaaba when they perform their obligatory 5 daily prayers. And one of the 5 pillars of the faith of Islam is that Muslims are required, if they're able to do so, to perform the Hajj pilgrimage at least once in their lifetime. And it includes circumambulation of the Kaaba. And if that term is not familiar to you, here it is. It is walking around the Kaaba in a circle. So multiple parts of the Hajj require pilgrims to walk around or circumambulate the Kaaba 7 times in a counterclockwise direction. And one of the things, for those of you who are astronomers or astrologers, might recognize by seeing this picture, this circumambulation is how much it resembles star trail photographs, which are taken when you point a camera at the pole star and then leave it open for exposure and see how the stars appear to circumambulate in the sky around the point at which we have where Polaris is located, which is currently the pole star for Earth. One other sacred place in the Middle East is the Umayyad Mosque in Damascus, Syria. It's all in the southeast corner of that mosque complex is something known as the Minaret of Jesus. As many of you probably know, the Muslim faith has a very detailed teaching about Jesus and his return. And it is believed that when Jesus returns to confront the Antichrist before the Day of Judgment, he will return at the Umayyad Mosque's Jesus Minaret. And you can see it here. There's a photo. And it is approximately 77 meters in height. And last that I've checked, it has not been damaged in the current round of fighting that's been going on in Syria, although it had been damaged at points in the past. off to a different corner of Asia, more to the north and northwest, are the Taban Bogod. These are located in the westernmost part of Mongolia, near the borders with Russia and China. And the Taban Bogod Mountains in the Mongolian language translates to the five sacred mountains. And they contain the five largest mountains in Mongolia. And the mountains are considered to be sacred to the local Tuva and the Kazakhs. And almost to the northeast, I should say, of Asia, we have the Kanon 33 temples in Japan. And these are very fascinating. The Saigantoji Pagoda, which is pictured here, also known as the Temple of the Blue Waves, is the Tendai Buddhist temple in eastern Honshu. And it is the first of 33 temples that comprise Japan's most famous pilgrimage circuit, the Saigoku Kanon. And Kanon is the Japanese name for the Bodhisattva of compassion. And so pilgrims make a tour of all or some of the 33 temples, each one of which is a manifestation of one of the characteristics or attributes of the Bodhisattva of compassion. And the final sacred place to mention is one that you can see is Adam's Peak, which is in Sri Lanka, and you can see a line of light that leads up the mountainside to a very beautiful structure, which is not pictured here, but I like this one that shows it from a little bit of distance with the light leading to the top. And Adam's Peak is a tall mountain located in Sri Lanka, and it's well known for its sacred footprint. That is a 1.... While Muslims and Christians ascribe to it ascribe it to be the footprint of Adam that was left behind when he exited the Garden of Eden. So just to summarize, as we saw, there are, from the original map, there are hundreds of sacred sites in Asia. And what we're able to find is that even though we have a notion of Asia being associated with Eastern religions, we find that throughout the region, in a number of places, more than just the ones that I've described, we see links or sites associated with great Christian figures as well, or Western religions, as well as names that we would recognize, or manifestations of those that we would recognize that are now part of hierarchy or have moved on and possibly moved out of our entire planetary system and on to greater work, some of which would benefit humanity and possibly even other parts of the solar system. And so those were the thoughts that I wanted to share with you about emerging light and the recognition of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Starling. Thank you very much. And now, let's refocus our inner sight to the continent of Australia. And I invite our speaker from Australia, Rebecca Hoot. Hi, Rebecca.
Hi, Alexander. Can you hear me?
Yes. Hear you.
Great. Great. May I share my screen?
Yes. Please.
Thank you.
Yes, we can see it.
Can you see it? Okay.
Yes.
Well, are you still there?
Yes.
The sound is coming in and out a little bit. Okay, hello everyone. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to contribute to the symphony today. I'm from the eastern coast of Australia, from just north of Brisbane, and I'm representing today our little working group here that we've been working here in different formations for I think 15 or 20 years, just very quietly in a small way. And it's a great honour to be part of the 2025 initiative in this way today. So to align with the continent of Australia, I invite everyone to just visualise for a moment from the place where you are on the globe, a line of light to the continent of Australia. And as you strengthen that line of light, you can also expand your consciousness to include many, many lines of light that everyone is extending from their countries to Australia just now. So the effect is of a beautiful mantle of threads of light surrounding the globe and extending to our continent, Australia. And nestled within that beautiful mantle are the centers that the continents themselves represent, the centers of our planet. And I invite you to imagine the vitality of those centers at this time of Wesak, as we all invoke the higher energies to come and strengthen the bodies of our planet. That we may, our planet Earth may be a vehicle of a light. Can you still hear? I hope so.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes, okay. Okay, thank you. Okay. So, leaving that vision to of the creative imagination to do its work, I now invite everyone to bring your attention to the screen. In sounding the note for the Australian continent today, we wish to acknowledge the traditional owners of our region, the Gubbi Gubbi people. And their lands include these sacred mountains named the Glasshouse Mountains by Captain Cook. And they have individual Aboriginal names in the Gubbi Gubbi language. And in the Gubbi Gubbi dreaming mythology, they form a family group, which you can see the sense of that in this image here. As we focus on recognizing the emerging light, we offer a seed thought from the alchemist and esotericist René Schwalla de Lubix, who says, "There will be light if the darkness feels its absence. The consciousness of the absence of light will create the call which will make the light shine. At this time in the life of our continent, there are many areas where the cloaking weight of darkness seems to oppress the impulse to light. Our nation began as a penal colony for the enactment of a harsh, retributive code of law centered around the selfish interests of a ruling class. Its foundation displaced an ancient culture and violently disenfranchised its people. The energetic resonance and intergenerational legacy of these founding acts continues to this day. An oppressive and selfish unwillingness to share dogs Australia's immigration policies and its attitude to asylum seekers and refugees. Religious intolerance, rooted in anxiety and selfishness, gives voice to the lower aspects of the nation's personality. And the extraction of the continent's rich mineral resources is being carried out with breathtaking lack of gratitude in a way that ignorantly damages and disrespects the nature kingdoms. In contemplating the exploitation of the mineral wealth of Australia, we are led to the rulers of the sign of Taurus. Here we see the god Vulcan, the esoteric and hierarchical ruler of Taurus, and his consort Venus, the orthodox ruler. Vulcan establishes relationship between the human and mineral kingdoms, while Venus, the mental energy of humanity, establishes relations between man and man, and nation and nation. As the smith who goes down into the depths to find the material to fashion the beautiful and the useful, Vulcan also stands for the soul, ruling the fashioning of both the inner man and the embryonic soul expression of the nations. Thus, humanity's relationship with the mineral kingdom offers a powerful gauge of our evolutionary progress from the angle of material selfishness and of human relations, and it provides a forge for the working out of the conscious as well as the destructive use of our planetary resources. One group in Australia currently expressing the consciousness of the absence of light in relation to the use of Australia's mineral and natural resources is the Lock the Gate Alliance. Their mission is to protect Australia's natural, cultural and agricultural resources from inappropriate mining and to educate and empower all Australians to demand sustainable solutions to food and energy production. This group aspires to treat its opponents with respect while actively blocking the expression of self-interested, environmentally damaging corporate behaviours. Potent gestures demonstrating concern for the treatment of asylum seekers also express a demand for the light. Recently, people came from all over the continent to stand in solidarity with staff at Lady Salento Hospital in a 10-day vigil to prevent the return of a sick refugee baby, Asha, and her mother to an inhumane offshore detention centre. Despite these calls of the Australian people for light, entrenched systemic inequality persists and much work still remains to be done to establish justice, healing and right relations, especially for Australia's traditional owners. An area fertile with thought forms of solution for the development of harmonious human relations is the field known as restorative justice, which offers processes for vitalizing communication and for bringing harmony from conflict. An Australian representation in this field is the Restorative Practices International Group. And members of our own group are also currently working on restorative and peace-building projects. The consciousness of the need for light is awake among the Australian people. But the desire for light requires for its fulfillment an energetic matrix nourished by thought forms of peace and love. One of our group members writes, "In the landscape of our inner world, our heart is the active magnet for the light. And when united with the quietude of higher mind, the luminosity is expanded to the outer world. One tool for the cultivation of such alignment is the labyrinth in Centennial Park in Sydney, which was gifted to the community as a pathway to peace. Wisdom keepers from 11 different faiths blessed the labyrinth at its official opening, walking it together in peace and silence." Across Australia during the Wesak period, Buddhist organisations hold multicultural festivals to celebrate Buddha's birthday. Public events foster multi-faith prayer and group meditation to promote peace and harmony amongst people. Australian group meditations for Wesak are also conducted by units of service linked with World Goodwill, as well as by small independent groups like ours, sitting privately with the aim of serving and stabilizing the light. The problems that are generating the call for light on our continent are Australian nuances of global issues that all humanity faces. And the talks of the previous speakers are demonstrating this really strongly. As DK says, the world is one world and its sufferings are one. Humanity is in truth a unity and the sins of humanity are also one. Its goal is one. And it is as one great human family that we must emerge into the future. At this time of the Wesak, we join with 2025 and all people of goodwill to aid in the sounding of the call that will make the light shine. May we form a strong conduit for the synthesizing blessings of love and wisdom that will vitalize the aspiration of all humanity. Thank you. Hello, Alexander.
Yes.
Sorry. I hope you heard that. Felt
yes.
Like I was in the...
Yes.
Okay, good. Oh, I will mute myself
Thank
again
Thank you very
now.
Much. Thank you very much, Rebecca,
yes.
For this deep note of alignment from your nation and your continent of Australia. Thank you. And now we bring our focus to the continent of Europe. And I invite Tomas Born from Czech Republic to speak on behalf of this continent. Tomas?
Yes, please. Can I please just share the slides? Is it possible?
Yes. Okay.
Okay, is it visible now? Is it okay? Is it, can everyone see? Let me just put...
We can see your screen and okay, waiting for the slides to come. Yes, we can
okay.
see it.
Okay. Okay, so first of all, hello everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to participate in this nice event. And I'm Tomas, I'm from Czech Republic, which is a small country, roughly in the middle of Europe. Some people say it's in the heart of Europe. And let me share with you a couple of images that came up as we're preparing for this meeting. And thinking of recognizing the emerging light, it is actually an everyday experience, because when you think of the first movements and when the night finishes and the first light appears during the day, it is these are moments of deep opportunity for get the inspiration of the first light and to think of this inspiration. And as the sun approaches the horizon, wherever you are, actually you can feel that every place is sacred at this moment. And it is, when I think also of let's say what was the maybe most important advice that was ever given by anyone, was that try to see the sunrise and maybe try to do it as many times as possible during the year, because it helps definitely to link up and to keep some alignment. Let me jump to the place which I was thinking of to share with you when thinking of Europe. And this is actually a bridge in Prague. It's called Charles Bridge. And it was built in 1357 by a clever king whose name was Charles IV, with the aim to help people to realize that they should be together and also to create a certain link between what could be called the heart of the city in Prague and the head of the city, which is in the castle. The king himself was also trying to create some kind of path where not only the king would walk, but also people could come and then maybe realize kind of unity which is there. You see the bridge early in the morning, where actually, and you see it from the point of the head towards the heart, where actually the sun will shortly appear. Another image which came in my mind when thinking of this event is then the Renaissance. Because if you think what was happening in Europe in the time that we had the great opportunity to realize, thanks to the art, of a certain rebirth and of our direct link and our role that we have in the universe. And actually it was in Italy, but let's say all over Europe, this great opportunity to realize our role and the opportunity then that we have on the earth and how we can participate on the propagation of light and bringing light into actual service. It's interesting that actually at this period also appears the picture of the birth of Venus, not only the birth of man, but also the mind which is able to, which is already liberated, which is pure, and it comes out of water. So not just the astral plane, but mental plane, which is then important for coming closer to actually realizing our role that we have on the earth and in the solar system. And when you take it from the art perspective, and you jump a little bit more towards science, you realize that most of the models that we use in trying to understand light comes actually from the way how we observe water. Because the waves and the model of the electromagnetic fields very, very much use actually the model that when a small drop of water comes into another bigger, let's say, volume of water, it creates waves. And this is the way how light propagates. At least this is the model that we use for the light propagation. It's interesting that actually the scientist who was very much working on that, his name was Maxwell, currently has also his name on Venus, because one part of the planet Venus currently is named after him. It's a small mountain which is just to bring and remember him. Inside ourselves, it is not just the model of light, but also the waves that somehow are the models and showing how light propagates are also inside ourselves. On the lower part of the screen, you can see three different shapes of waves that show how our cardiovascular system reacts to the impulses that come from the heart. Actually, when we think inside ourselves, we are very much similar to the solar system, because the heart, if you take it as the sun, or compare it to the sun, is just trying to beat and provide, let's say, volumes of blood that circulate across the body. And the way how the venous, how the vascular system responds to this quanta or volumes of blood is a little bit similar how we can try to react to the light and to the inspiration which is just coming. In this case, it's very important that the blood actually can get from the heart to the very cell on the periphery. And it's crucial that the vascular system is able to absorb the pressure, which is very high at the point of the heart, but gradually diminishes so that it's acceptable to individual cells. And three different valves, waveforms, which are given on the lower part, show just three different status of let's say showing the health of people. On the left-hand side, this is a very healthy status, so it means a kind of healthy, aligned person who responds very conveniently to the impulses coming from the heart and is able to transform it into a very good service for the cells. The middle part shows already someone who has changed and where the capability of the vascular system is diminished. And the right side is actually what is one of the prevailing difficulty all over the world, which is called atherosclerosis, and the difficulties in the reaction to the alignment and to the acceptance of the pulses, hence creating cardiovascular disease. Thinking of how to accept, feel the inspiration of the early morning or of the whatever light that comes in, let me share with you a tree I like a lot. I come to several occasions whenever I can to this spot with great admiration, because when you realize that the trees and lots of other creatures in the world are already participating so actively from the very morning all the time, trying to create a link and maintain the link to the light, and serving not only for themselves, when this tree is able to, in the cooperation of the earth, to transform the light and the soil into a structure which actually helps also others to come closer to the light and to heaven. It is a model, and also I can say a very good friend with whom the great invocation can be sounded. So thank you very much for your attention. I wish all of you to be able to use the inspiration and turn it into service most effectively possible. Again, thank you very much for the opportunity to participate here. Thank you.
Thank you, Tomáš. And now we will bring our focus to the group centers connecting linking and aligning with the centers of the new group of world servers. And we go into our meditation. Letting in the light. Standing as one united group, the heart center of the new group of world servers. We affirm the fact of group fusion and integration within the heart center of the new group of world servers, mediating between hierarchy and humanity. I am one with my group brothers, and all that I have is theirs. May the love which is in my soul pour forth to them. May the strength which is in me lift and aid them. May the thoughts which my soul creates reach and encourage them. Alignment. We connect with the lights of all the continents. Weaving into one tapestry of planetary unification. The ancient light, the present light, and the future light, radiating through all the nations, on all the continents, through one humanity. We project a line of lighted energy towards the spiritual hierarchy of the planet, the planetary heart, the great ashram of Sanat Kumara. We project the light towards the Christ, the heart center of the spiritual hierarchy of the planet. Extend the line of light towards Shambhala, the center where the will of God is known. fire interlude. Using the creative imagination, visualize the energies of light, love, and the will to good pouring throughout the planet and becoming anchored on Earth in prepared physical plane centers through which the plan can manifest. We visualize the triangle of Shambhala, hierarchy, and humanity. Recognizing our responsibility as members of the new group of world servers, working as mediators between hierarchy and humanity. And as we hold this alignment, we meditate on the seed thoughts. Recognizing emerging light. I see, and when the eye is opened, all is illumined. as a group, refocus the consciousness within the periphery of the great ashram. Together, we sound the mantra. In the center of all love, I stand. From that center, I will outward move. From that center, I, the one who serves, will work. May the love of the Divine Self be shared abroad in my heart, through my group, and throughout the world. Visualize the downpouring spiritual inflow released from Shambhala through the hierarchy and streaming into humanity through the prepared channel. See this channel getting stronger and more unified as we approach the moment of great alignment in the Vesak Valley. Consider how these important energies can establish the pathway of light for the coming world teacher, the Christ. As we sound the great invocation together, visualize the outpouring of light and love and power from the spiritual hierarchy through the five planetary inlands: London, Darjeeling, New York, Geneva, Tokyo, irradiating the consciousness of the whole human race. From the point of light within the mind of God, let light stream forth into the human minds. Let light descend on earth. From the point of love within the heart of God, let love stream forth into the hearts of men. May the coming one return to earth. From the center where the will of God is known, let purpose guide the little human wills. The purpose which the masters know and serve. From the center, which we call the human race, let the plan of love and light work out, and may it seal the door where evil dwells. Let light and love and power restore the plan on Earth? Thank you very much. As we enter the festival of Vesak, 7 days period, we encourage you to participate in as many online and offline meetings on the physical plane, thus connecting with different centers, with different groups, contributing into weaving of the network of light and creating this great alignment of the Vesak precipitation and distribution. On the screen you see a number of the meetings that you can attend online, and we ask you, if you know about any other online meetings, to share the information about those on our Facebook page. You can, on your control panel, on your screen, you can get, in the handouts section, you can download the Vesak source list with links to all these meetings and the dates. Not all the websites yet have the actual links to the broadcasts or the schedule of the meetings, but please check those. And let's, as I said, share any information about any other meetings. And we invite you to share the joy of this time and the spirit of this great Vesak alignment with people around you. And you can organize your own meditation, or maybe you can have a circle gathering where you just celebrate with your friends, keeping the high note of this time and shine through your inner light, and that would be very valuable contribution to this Vesak alignment, even if you're not gonna name any technical details of this event, but connecting with the light within yourself and with the light of those who are around you would definitely contribute into the strengthening of the Vesak alignment. And as I already mentioned, the exact time of the Vesak full moon is on April 22nd at 5:25 a.m. At GMT. On the screen you can see time in planetary centers for the Vesak alignment. Please, if you have a chance, be in meditation at the exact moment. And also on the source list that you can download from the control panel, you see the link to the Vesak video. So it's a video produced by Lucis Trust with a cooperation with Justin Wilkinson, So it might be something you would consider to share on your Facebook. Very inspiring video. And thank you again. And let's be interconnected and connected throughout this festival and for the entire month till the next full moon in Gemini. It's a sacred month of holding the light of Shambhala, and we will reconvene again on May 20th for the Gemini Festival webinar to receive and distribute the light from Christ and from hierarchy, distributing it to humanity. And our guest of the Gemini Festival webinar will be Claire Bainon from New Zealand, and the topic of your presentation would be Many as One. And we will focus on the work of distribution of light throughout the planet. Thank you very much. You can find the recorded recording of this webinar on our website 2025initiative.org, along with all other webinars from the past. And at the end, let's together sound the Gayatri. O Thou who gives the sustenance to the universe, from whom all things proceed, to whom all things return, unveil to us the face of the true spiritual sun, hidden by a disk of golden light, that we may know the truth and do our whole duty as we journey to thy sacred feet. Thank you.